Good morning to all. On behalf of IIP technical team, I, Dr. Rutra Mohan, welcome you to this webinar on knee muscle strength and endurance evaluation on isokinetic machine. Today's resource person is Dr. Ejaz Ashay. We are streaming live on IIP India YouTube channel. You can subscribe to this channel to get regular updates about our webinars. You can also follow IIP updates on various social media. If you have any questions during the presentation, you can put them in the chat section. We'll address those questions at the end of the presentation. So now I request Dr. Ejaz Ashay to please take over. Yes, you can start.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Nice Saturday morning here, raining outside. But yes, we are here to speak about isokinetic machine. And we have a team of physios. Dr. Aryan is with me and Dr. Diab. They both work on a sports department, basically on sports injuries and rehab. And today we'll be explaining you how exactly we do the evaluation of a muscle before sending a sports person or person back to the activity. Normally, we have seen maximum time people going back to sports, and within 1 or 2 days, they come back with the injury. The biggest reason is because we are not able to evaluate their muscle properly. And now we got this isokinetic machine where exactly we know and we targeted, okay, fine, is it the endurance or is it the strength which we need to work on? So I'll give a simple example of a Spanish player who had come down recently from Kerala Blasters team, had an injury. And they kept on working on him on a strength training, and he used to go and play first 10-15 minutes, and after 15-20 minutes he used to get this injury again. He used to get the pain and stiffness again. So when he came down here, we had a look and we decided to do the evaluation, and then we came to know it wasn't the strength. His strength is much better, but it was the endurance which was causing the problem. And whenever he used to run for 15-20 minutes again, that strain used to come back. So we started training him on endurance program, and that's how we got the result. And the best thing was when he went back and first match he scored 2 goals and he played full 90 minutes of the game. That was the best thing. So today we want to show you that how we evaluate each muscle and what are the basic components of this machine, what are the gadgets, what are the equipments which we use to evaluate each and every muscle of the body. Before that, we would like to show you our center, which is known as Adam Willey Physio Rehab Center. And I'm really thankful to Dr. Sanjeev Jha, President, Dr. Anamalia, the Secretary, and Dr. Ruchi, who has given us an opportunity to come live and show exactly how we are competitive in this world. Basically, everyone thinks that it's Australia, South Africa, other international countries who are coming up with the sports evaluation units, sports evaluation training program. But we in India have it here, and that's what we are doing. And we would like you guys to see and give us a feedback and see that whenever you get a chance, whenever you get an opportunity, you can come back to us and ask questions about it. And we are ready to answer those questions. If we don't, then we can go through other books or go through other stuff and see that we are able to answer your questions. Let me take you around first. Adam Willey Physio Rehab Center, which is under Indian Red Cross Society, Mumbai. This is Asia's one of the biggest physical therapy and rehab center, where we have ortho, neuro, sports, cardio, and pediatric, and plus aqua rehab, where we have all the facilities under one roof, which is on 15,000 square feet. So let me show you a small video of our center where you can have a look, and after that we can start with Dr. Aryan and Dr. Ria. They'll show you how we evaluate knee muscles.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks for cooperating with us and watching that small video. And now we are back here. So we are doing the evaluation of a very young basketball player. Came with an injury, got it done, came out of it. Now we have done the evaluation, but we just want you to show the evaluation of a knee, how we can do it on. He's a professional basketball player. Before that, I would like Dr. Aryan and Dr. Ria to show you exactly how the isokinetic machine works and what are the components of this isokinetic machine. Please carry on, Dr. Ria and Dr. Aryan.
Thank you for the warm introduction, Dr. Jas. Good morning to everyone, and it is a pleasure to be a part of today's webinar to present a talk on isokinetic devices, an interesting topic, of course. So, as Dr. Jas rightly mentioned, me along with my colleague Dr. Aryan will be presenting a live introduction on how we can assess and evaluate the knee strength and endurance mass of the muscles using this isokinetic device. So let's briefly go through the highlights of today's webinar. In today's webinar, we would be talking about, firstly, what exactly is an isokinetic device, what a brief description on what are its applications in different conditions, what are the different equipments associated with this huge machine, a live demonstration and interpretation of the data that we obtain of knee musculature strength and endurance evaluation. And most importantly, what are the benefits of using this device over other methods of treatment and evaluation? So to begin with, as there's a general notion that we commonly hear amongst many physiotherapy professionals as well as physiotherapy students, that isokinetic devices are useful only as a part of sports rehabilitation program. But that is not completely true, because apart from athletic rehabilitation, it also finds its application in geriatric rehabilitation, occupational therapy, hand therapy specifically using certain tools which are specific for hand rehabilitation. Apart from this, we also use it to accommodate the functional demands of industrial rehabilitation. So it's a very versatile machine, not only specific to one particular population, but it is it is applicable to a diverse population. So apart from this, the highlight of this machine is this comes with four modes of resistance for the purpose of training and evaluation. Firstly, the isometric mode. So in the isometric mode, when we are using it for the purpose of evaluation, we are basically assessing the maximal capacity of the muscle. So this means when we are evaluating a particular muscle using this machine on an isometric mode of resistance, we are getting the data of what is the maximal capacity of that muscle, based on which we can use the appropriate resistance for training of that muscle. So when we are using the isometric mode for the purpose of training, this machine provides submaximal amount of resistance throughout the movement so that we are not over or under training the muscle in any aspect. Second is the isotonic mode of resistance. Isotonic, as we all know as professionals, it has the concentric and the eccentric mode. And this machine is capable of providing both of these modes of training and evaluation depending on what is the requirement of the muscle at the moment. So when we are using it for the purpose of evaluation, it provides the appropriate resistance and gives a report of what is the endurance of the muscle. And when we are using it for the purpose of training, we can use it to first train the muscle in an open chain or on a single joint. And also in the later stage, we can use it for functional treatment, as most of the activities of our daily living are based on isotonic movement. So it's not just a machine that you sit on a chair and you just do the movement and you go home. It also has functional applications. So if you're lacking in a certain activity, you can also train yourself to become better at that activity using this machine. Third is the isokinetic mode. So in the isokinetic mode, basically the speed of the movement will remain constant as will be set in the machine, but at a variable resistance. So we can vary the resistance of the movement at any point during the treatment or evaluation, but it will work at a constant speed as we set in the machine before we begin. And the unit of measurement is degrees per second. So it is an X amount of degrees that you need to cover within a second. This is how we train and evaluate the isokinetic mode of resistance. Last, the CPM mode, or the continuous passive mode. So in this mode, the movement is completely passive. There is not much participation from the patient. So this is useful in certain cases where in certain acute orthopedic cases like post-surgery, say for example, when there is not much movement which is allowed or there is a restriction of movement, but to maintain the integrity of the joint and the muscle, we need to perform certain passive movements, which is done using this machine. Also in certain neurological cases where the movement is not possible or is hampered due to weakness, we can use this machine in order to maintain the integrity of the joint and the muscle and to prevent disuse or stiffness. So this was a very brief introduction to give an overview of what exactly we would be talking on. In the later part of the webinar, we would be discussing on what are the different equipments and a live demonstration of how we do the evaluation. So let's go dive into the depth of the next part of the webinar. Over to you, Dr. Aryan.
Thanks, Dr. Ria. This is something which I want you guys to know exactly all about this machine. Trust me, when it came from first time when it came to India, and everyone thought it's only with the evaluation on Yuvraj Singh and decided he doesn't need a surgery. That's where we did an evaluation on his muscle in 2007 before going for a World Cup. We decided he doesn't need a surgery. His muscle strength is good enough. His muscle endurance is good enough. He had some ACL muscle fibers which were torn action of a knee. But trust me, when we checked his strength and when we checked his endurance, we took a decision he doesn't need a surgery. He can go ahead because the musculature of Yuvraj Singh or any sports person is much better than the normal person. And once you do the evaluation, and Dr. Aryan will explain you how do we do the evaluation and what is how the graph comes on it, and we are sure about it. And there's nothing hidden. We cannot say, okay, grade one, grade two, grade three, grade four in this. There's nothing hidden. Everything is seen and everything is taken care of after that. And sending the report to the doctors and explaining them, this is what we feel and this is what we can do with this isokinetic machine. And now we have Dr. Aryan with us who can explain you about the gadgets and about the machine as well. Come, doctor.
All right. So let's get first oriented with this equipment. As we see here, the projection is called the exercise set, which has a small opening for the attachment of different tools we use for the purpose of evaluation and the strength training. We can also raise or lower this exercise set with this switch to accommodate the joint to be treated. As we see here, the multiple openings on the circumference of this device for the attachment of range of motion stopper and the armrest. We have two range of motion stopper, which serves to limit the range so that the muscle will work in the targeted or the desired range of motion. We can also change the angle of this exercise set accordingly through this knob. So we can see how flexible and accommodating this device is. Moving on, as we can see a set of tools here, which we use for the evaluation purposes, and 302, which we use for the larger joint like shoulder or hip, because it's got a larger lever length. This is grip strengthening tool, which we use for the strengthening of different types of grip, like normal grip or the pistol grip. This is pistol tool we use for the strengthening of the different types of pinches, like tip to tip pinch, lateral pinch, or the 3-point pinch, so that we can enhance the. This is tool number 701, which we are going to use for our evaluation later on. The landmark here on is the fulcrum of this tool. This marking on this tool depict the appropriate lever length, and here on the this is the sim pad where we attach at the lower end of this tool and strap it over the patient's shin. As we can see, there are multiple accessories, sports related accessories, which we are used for the functional and the task oriented activities. Let's take an example, the cricket ball, which we use for the assessment, functional assessment of the bowler at different angle while bowling. The data obtained here will give us an idea at what angle or at which phase of bowling the athletes requires the strength and endurance training. Similarly, we have bat also, so we can train a cricketer, a batsman, to play a specific shot like cover drive or a straight drive to retrain his muscle and endurance his muscle, which he is lacking. Golf stick as well.
That's it.
Okay. So as we saw, as explained by Dr. Aryan, the versatility of this machine is so good that we can use different tools to accommodate and use to train all the joints and all the muscles, as well as how we can train different functional movements. So I hope we were successful in explaining to you briefly what this machine is about, what are the different equipments, activities, and movements using the part of the webinar, which is the evaluation of the knee, for which we have with us today Mr. Melvin, a professional basketball player, and who has been undergoing rehabilitation and training with us in the sports rehab department. Mr. Melvin, please come.
Till the time we get Mr. Melvin set on the machine, so Aryan was talking about throwing of the ball. So kya hota hai? I'll explain you. Whenever we train someone with a shoulder injury and maximum time they go back and they start throwing the ball against us, what is the biggest reason? Because hum log unko training karate hain, wo yahan se karate hain. But when you have to throw the ball from boundary line, yeah, those just so you have to pull your shoulder back. That's the rotator cuff muscle where the subscapularis come in action. So we always train on this machine and we train the shoulder rehab. So we'll show you on that. We always take it behind and then throw. That's where the rehab starts. So normally we do this exercise for the rotation, take it behind as much as you can into the machine, and then we slowly pull up. Fine, he's able to do this, but once he throws from the boundary line, the pain starts again. Same thing happens with the cricket bat handle. Now we have seen lots of coaches saying ki bhai hamare paas jo batsman hai wo 10 baar shot khelta hai aur 11th ball catch deta hai. So what happens, it's not a technical fault, it's basically his muscles are not endurant enough to continuously play that ball. So once we check it here, we come to know after fifth straight drive or fifth on drive or fifth off drive, what happens is basically the muscle is getting fatigued. So he is not able to grasp it properly. He's not able to have that kind of endurance to continue with those shots. So we tell them, okay, exactly what is happening with his tricep muscle, what is happening with his wrist muscle, or what is happening with his grip. Maybe his grip is not strong enough to hold it. So we do the evaluation on that and get on to the results. That's the easiest way to explain the coaches. Basically, it's not the technique which is causing the problem. It's basically endurance and the strength of a muscle, which is, I think Melvin is ready, yes?
Yes.
We have Melvin here with us, and Melvin, as I told you, is a professional basketball player. So we'll show you the evaluation. Dr. Ria and Dr. Aryan will start the evaluation program. So please have a look, and if you have any questions, please write it down. And once the webinar is at the end of this program, we can just discuss the questions and we can answer your questions.
All right, that was a great explanation of Rajas. So moving on, let's begin with the practical demonstration of how we'll be evaluating Mr. Melvin's knee muscles today, namely the quadriceps and the hamstring muscles. So we would be assessing one at a time. We are beginning with the quadriceps muscle first. For the purpose of demonstration, we would only be doing the one leg today, the right side today. But when we are doing a general evaluation for a patient, we usually compare both the sides. So we do the right side as well as the left side. All right. So to first show you how we set up the evaluation, this is the positioning chair. To accommodate Mr. Melvin's height, we adjust the chair accordingly at an inclination. The seat is inclined, so is the backrest. These are the two thigh straps to support the thighs to prevent any trick movements from occurring when we are doing the evaluation. So we get a true value of the muscle strength. We have adjusted the exercise head using this switch. So that the fulcrum, as Dr. Aryan had mentioned, the fulcrum of this tool corresponds with the joint line of Mr. Melvin's knee. And the lever length is adjusted accordingly. So whatever is the lever, we generally set it up on the machine so that the machine calculates the appropriate resistance to be provided during the evaluation. The shin pad is fixed onto the Mr. Melvin's knee and strapped comfortably. To prevent any other trick movements from happening, the thigh of the other leg is also strapped and supported on a stool. So today we would be evaluating your quadriceps muscle completely, all right? This is the monitor. You would be getting visual graphs on this monitor. So based on how much force you are putting on the shin pad, you will get a visual graph over here showing you what is the value that you are putting through. Try to put your maximum effort as you can. We would be doing the isometric and isotonic assessment of Mr. Melvin's quadriceps muscle today. First, we would be beginning with the isometric resistance, which would measure the maximal capacity of the quadriceps muscle. And the machine will calculate a percentage of that value and set it up to provide the appropriate resistance for isotonic evaluation. All right. So Mr. Melvin, I'll briefly explain what you're supposed to do. We're doing the isometric assessment of your quadriceps muscle. I hope you're comfortable with the setup.
Yeah.
All right. So what you need to do is, in isometric assessment, when I ask you to push, you need to push in the direction of knee extension, but there will not be an actual movement, okay? So you only have to push in the direction of extension and hold with the maximum force that you can apply while you are pushing on the shin pad. We will be doing three trials of this assessment and displayed in the isotonic resistance mode. Need to some degree of extension, and I will lock the device to this range because we are assessing Mr. Melvin's quadriceps at this angle. All right. So are you ready?
Yes.
At the count of three, you have to start pushing.
Yeah.
All right. Let's go. 1, 2, 3. Push. Keep pushing. Keep pushing. Try to. That's good. So you need to try to keep your graph above this line. Okay. So that's value. That's 48. 48 pounds of force is what you could put in your first try. Let's see how you go in the second try. All right. Are you ready?
Yes.
Let's go. 1, 2, 3. Push. Keep pushing. Keep pushing. Keep pushing. That's good. Stop. Ready for the third one?
Yeah.
Let's go. 1, 2, 3. Push. Push, 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 push. Stop. That's good. So now I save the data. And Mr. Levin can. And I unlock the tool as well. I can take some rest.
Okay, we have seen some of the movements coming from the hip. No cheating, Melvin. So he's trying to push his best. So what happens normally, any patient, any person after the rehab is trying to use all the muscles. When they push it and you see that the hip is moving as well. So check that whether hip movement is there. Everyone knows the main muscle of quadriceps is rectus femoris. So whenever you do the extension of the knee and flexion of the hip, automatically the hip starts moving. So you need to be careful with that whenever you're evaluating the muscle. So you need to have a look at hip as well. So try to keep your hip down.
Yes.
Just use your knee.
All right. So we will proceed with the next test, which is a measure of endurance of the quadriceps muscle using the isotonic mode of resistance, as I mentioned previously. So again, I've entered the lever length as we have set up on the tool. All right. The resistance is calculated by the machine itself, as we can see it here. It's 16.8. If it's not clearly visible, I would just mention it. It's 16.8, which was calculated based on Mr. Melvin's isometric strength. All right. So in this test, what we are going to do today is you need to do repetitive movement of knee extensions, okay, at your comfortable pace. All right, so there is no much force, not no speed, it's a normal pace. And you have to continue doing this until you feel your muscle is completely fatigued and you can no longer continue the test. All right, when you feel so, you can just let me know and we can stop the test. Okay, so are you ready?
Yeah.
Well rested? Okay. So we will start at the count. That his muscle was fatigued. So this is how we sort of interpret on how much is the endurance of Mr. Melvin's muscle. So as we can see, his endurance at the moment is 45 seconds of knee extensions repetitively. All right. So as I mentioned earlier, we always do a comparison of both the sides, left versus right. But for today's webinar, we would be only demonstrating the right side. In a similar way, we perform the left one as well. So we have got the data for isometric and isotonic strength assessment for Mr. Melvin's muscle. Moving on to the next muscle, the hamstring muscle, a very important muscle again. So it will be demonstrated by Dr. Aryan. Let's go.
So for your hamstring muscle, I need you to lie down on your stomach. Lie down.
Very importantly, it is essential to lock the chair before you put the patient on the bed, otherwise the bed will just wait.
Do the movement. Do the movement, check it. Up. Come little downward. Do the movement now. Okay,
perfect. We're using this belt to stabilize his back so that there is no trick movement or strain coming on the back.
So first we are checking his isometric strength of his hamstring muscle. We'll lock it here. What we did earlier in the cordyceps strength assessment, we are doing the same with your hamstring muscle. Okay, so you need to bend your knee for 3 seconds and hold it for 3 seconds with your full force, as much as you can. Okay, you are ready? Relax your shoulder. You are ready?
Yeah.
On a count of three, we'll start. Okay, 3, 2, 1, start. Keep bending, keep bending, keep bending. Stop. We'll do the 2 more trials. Okay. 3, 2, 1, start. One more. 3, 2, 1, start. Okay. Stop. Now we are going to check his endurance of his hamstring muscle. For this, you need to do the repeated movement until your muscle gets fatigued. Okay?
Yeah.
On a count of 3, we'll start. 3, 2, 1, start. Thank you.
come down.
All right, we are done with this Mr. Melvin evaluation part. Now we are going to do the interpretation letter.
All right, we will share the reports on the screen. So we will share the reports of Mr. Melvin's previous assessment data that we had done during the session for your reference. Jump on to the interpretation. Certain points to remember when you are performing the evaluation. In certain conditions, when the muscle is very weak, there may be certain sensations that the athlete or the patient might experience, which include pain, cramping, or any kind of funny sensation. We need to tell the patient that if you have any such feeling while you are doing the movement, you need to report immediately and the test needs to stop. Because this is the movement where the resistance is not controlled by us, it is very important to be careful when we are doing this kind of assessment, especially on a geriatric patient, where the patient might feel that it is normal to feel that way, but it is not always true. So we need to explain to the patient that if you have any kind of pain or cramping occurring when you are doing the assessment or the treatment, please let us know. If there is a put an ice pack over the area, and that would mean that we need to give the part some rest before we do a next session of evaluation or treatment. So we need to delay a session even if it is required, but we cannot force the patient to do it if it is acutely injured. Certain conditions like a hamstring strain or a quadriceps strain, which is acute, or even if the phase of inflammation passed the phase of inflammation, there may be certain range of motion restriction or there may be a painful range of motion. So we need to make sure that we are not crossing the painful range of motion. We need to do this assessment only within the pain-free range of motion, which can be very well adjusted using this tool. As we saw, we can always lock the tool in the desired range of motion using either the tool by shifting it manually, or we can also use the range of motion stopper as we had mentioned previously, so that we can work within the pain-free or the available range of motion. So there is no restriction if we go to see in this machine when it comes to assessment or evaluation. If you don't have a certain range of motion, if you don't have a complete range of motion, train your muscle in the available range of motion. We've got it. All right. So let's move on to the interpretation. As we can see the report. First, the isometric knee extension report, comparing the left extension versus the right extension. We can see the objectivity of the data. It is measured in pounds, and the machine also calculates the percentage deficit in left versus right. So we can explain to the patient that, well, your graph seemed pretty good on the left side, but the right side seemed pretty weak. So the patient knows, okay, my right side is not very weak. It's about 12.3% deficient compared to the left extension. So we know that we need to work on right extension more than the left extension and how much we need to work. Moving on, so this was the isometric assessment, giving us the maximal capacity of the quadriceps muscle, and this was the deficit. So we have a number. So this serves as a baseline parameter when we are doing the assessment on day one, which we train the muscle, and after a couple of sessions, when we do a re-evaluation to see whether the rehabilitation program was effective or not, we can check this objective data, whether it has improved in terms of the percentage deficit or not. Moving on to the next report, which is the data describing the isometric knee flexion. So basically the isometric strength of the hamstring muscles. As we can see here, again, it's very objective. We can again see that the right flexors or the right hamstrings are again 5% weaker than the left flexors. So which is not too bad, which gives the patient sigh of relief that, okay, my hamstrings are not too bad. So that's good to know, the objective data, which we can again reevaluate after a couple of after our exercise programs. Okay, so this is the endurance report for knee extensors, basically the quadriceps muscle. So here we can see that the right extensors are again weaker in endurance by 8.9% compared to the left. So which again tells us it's a very direct data. So there's no complication or, you know, it's not very difficult. Any person with any level of experience can know what the results are. So that's useful. So we again know that the right extensors are lacking in endurance as well as strength for Mr. Melvin. Let's move on to the flexors. The endurance of hamstring flexors is better on the right side compared to the left. So we know that we need to only work on the strength training for right flexors. And we need to work on the endurance of the left flexors. All right. So this was all about how to read a patient's report. And as we could see, it's not very complicated. It's a very direct measure of what we need to work on and what is the current baseline parameter. All right.
All right, thanks, Dr. Ria, Dr. Aryan, Melvin. Okay, now some of the points which we need to know, basically, we haven't put Melvin directly on this machine. You need to know that we need to take him first for the warm-up stretches, and he has been working out for some days in the exercise department. He has done some hydro treadmill sessions. He has done a lot of endurance training with us. And as Dr. Ria rightly said, the weakness of quadriceps muscle, if you see the isometric 12.3% lesser than the left one, when we compare it to the left one, what happens basically is a basketball player and he has to jump and come down. The maximum injuries which happen, if I ask Melvin, you go from the right side, when you play from the right side, how much weight you are able to take? You know, a simple basketball player, when he has to jump from one leg, his body weight gets multiplied by 9 times. So if the Melvin is 90 kgs or 80 kgs, let's take a weight of Melvin. What's his weight?
89.
Say 90 kgs he is already. It gets multiplied by 9 times. That is 9 nines are 81. It's 810 kg pressure. Can you believe this 810 kg pressure coming to the cartilage? Not the weight, remember that. It's the pressure which comes to the cartilage, causing the degeneration. That's the biggest reason why orthopedic surgeon, after doing the ACL surgery, always prefer not to do weight bearing exercises, because it causes the degeneration, because your muscle has become really weak. You're lost 40 to 60% of the quadriceps muscle strength. And when you put load directly on that, that's where you're not able to play any sports later on after the surgeries. This is what was happening earlier days in 80s, 70s, when people used to go through under knee surgery, ACL surgery. What was happening after that? They never used to be able to come and play fully full 100% strength. The biggest reason was, as a physio, we were not able to evaluate their muscle strength and endurance, and we used to send them directly on a weight-bearing exercise. So what we do here after the surgery, if it's an ACL surgery or if it's like normal knee surgery or any kind of problem they have, so we try to check the range of motion first. Once the range of motion is full, we work on endurance. We don't work on strength directly. Try to understand, since 20 years, what we are doing is learning that we need to start with the endurance exercise first to get the elasticity of a muscle fiber back to the sports person. So once a sports person starts directly on strengthening, what happens? The muscle fiber gets tighter and stiffer, but it gets stronger. That means fatigueness, chance of fatigueness coming back is much quicker.
So, but when you do the endurance training, you get the flexibility back, you get the endurance of the elasticity of a muscle fiber back, and then do the strengthening, chances of recurring injury is minimum. So as a physio, what we understand when we do the evaluation, we saw that his strength as compared to the left one is 12.3% lesser than the left one. So what we do, we still work on endurance first and then get onto the strength, because we have to increase the elasticity of a muscle fiber. It's not necessary you need to have this isokinetic machine for a training program. Like, we have done the evaluation with him. Now we'll give him a program, because he works in Central Railways, he plays for Central Railways, he has to go for the camps. So we give him a program which he does in gym, and he works out in a gym for the strengthening and endurance program as well. Next, which we want to talk about is stretching, which is must after and before evaluation. We need to do that. It should not get fatigue, and the warm up before coming to the gym. We allowed him to do 10 minutes of cycling and some of the stretches before he came for the evaluation. So we know muscle is warmed up, and because when we put a direct strain on the muscle, it might cause a strain to your quadriceps muscle, and your evaluation programs come back to zero. So what we need to do is send them for the warm up first, make them do 10 to 15 minutes of warm up stretching. Yeah, if it's in somewhere in north side in Kashmir, or if you go to other places which are cold, like in Brazil, sorry, in Germany, where they do the training under the snow, you need at least 45 minutes to warm up that muscle. But in Bombay, yes, it's humid, it's hot. It doesn't take us more than 10 to 15 minutes to get it warmed and stretched. So if you are somewhere on north side where it's cold, take your time, let the muscle get warmed up properly, then stretch it and then bring them on the machine. But here we can do it in 10 to 15 minutes, warm it up, stretch it, and bring them back. Other thing, when we do, every physio, all of us know, and the main muscle which is taking the load is gluteus medius. If your gluteus medius is weak and you start with a weight-bearing exercise, you're causing unnecessary strain to the ligaments, you're causing unnecessary strain to the joint. So what we do, we build up the muscle, which is the hip, gluteus medius, and maximus muscle with isometric exercises. Why isometric in gluteus medius? Because it's a weight-bearing muscle, maximum load comes on that, so maximum pressure comes on that. If it's stronger, less is the pressure on knee. But yes, quadriceps muscle, lot of endurance training, and then strength and power training. So weight-bearing exercises we can do with the hip, non-weight-bearing exercises we can start with the hip. Even if the knee is injured, you can build up the hip muscle till the time knee gets healed, and start with, when you start with a weight-bearing muscle, weight-bearing training, 60%, 70% of your body weight is taken by the hip. Minimum pressure comes to the knee, and your cartilage, your knee is safe for the other activities. So you can carry on with your sports. Any other thing you want to discuss about machine? Yeah. So benefit, Dr. Ria wants to speak about?
Yeah.
Benefits of the come. We can sit and do it because it's much easier.
Yeah. Thank you. So coming to the most important point, as one would wonder, why use this machine over other methods of treatment and evaluation? There are various other ways in which we can do. Well, that's true. They are more economical and they are easy, but so is this. The benefits of this machine over other methods like MMT that we commonly use is that MMT is a very subjective way of assessing a muscle strength, whereas this equipment provides a better evaluation of data where there are no trick movements possible because everything is so well stabilized. And along with that, it also provides a visual graph. So it makes easier for the patient as well as the therapist to understand whether they are putting the appropriate force or whether they have the appropriate force or not. And it is completely on the muscle because there is very less chance of trick movement in you when you're using this equipment versus when you are doing a MMT using your hands. So it is also more reliable compared to an MMT method of testing. Apart from that, the objectivity of the data helps in effective clinical decision making. So also useful for the therapist when they are deciding whether should we start with a strength training or whether should we give a endurance training program. So when we are designing a program for an athlete, it's not just any random program. It's based on the data that we have obtained, and we have a reasoning when we are making a program of why we are making a strength program versus why we are making an endurance program. Apart from this, it also offers task-specific functional rehabilitation. So as we had seen, we have certain accessories which provide rehabilitation to train a certain activity or certain task, such as the cricket ball helps in managing the bowling movement or retraining or making it better the way the bowler is bowling, or the cricket bat helps in making your strokes better, making your shots better against resistance, etc., etc. Apart from sports, we also saw that it is also useful in certain industrial rehabilitation, as we have the tools for it. As we saw it on our right side, we have the grip tool, the pinch tool, the steering wheels, a lot of tools. So it's a very versatile machine, as I keep mentioning. But so we can also train the patient functionally apart from just performing open chain movements. Last but not the least, as complicated as it looks, it's not. It's very easy to use and very easy to operate. All you need to know is the technicality of the equipment and you're good to go. So this was all about today's webinar, describing what the equipment is, what the equipment does, where is it useful, and how to evaluate the muscles of the knee joint. So so another point.
Okay, now we heard about machine, we heard about isometric, isotonic training programs, and as well as isokinetic, which we do on this. And the most important thing what we can do on this is before sending, what happens is normally when we send these players back to the team where the coach assesses them or the trainers assess them, the problem is the result comes, he's unfit, he's not fit enough to play. What is the biggest reason why he is not fit enough to play? It's not that we haven't treated them properly. It's not that physio hasn't taken care of them. It's only because we haven't functionally trained them. Now in this machine, what we do, we functionally train them. We see if it's a footballer. Now today we did a quadricep and a hamstring training program or evaluation. So I know what's a quadricep strength. So if I have someone who is going to play as a striker, has to shoot the ball, which is 20 to 40 degree of extension of a knee. So is he having enough strength to do that? He's having good strength to do squats. He's having good strength to run. He's having good strength to do any activity. But is he having enough strength to dribble after three players and then shoot the ball in the goal? That's where it comes into action and we say, okay, fine. This is the strength which has to be more than 200% to get him back when he goes for a fitness test. Otherwise, what happens when they go for a functional fitness test? Nowadays, it's a functional fitness. It used to be a fitness test. Now it's a functional fitness test. When the player goes back to the sports, what happens is, as a striker, when he's not able to shoot the ball after dribbling three to four players, that means his muscle is getting fatigued. He doesn't have enough endurance to keep that strength stable till the time he reached the top of the knee to shoot the ball. So what we need to do is build up that strength functionally and tell the coach, okay, first 10 days you can train him like this. This is the way you can train him and then get back him in the team. Otherwise, what happened? He'll get this injury again and he'll cause a problem to his knee. He's got a problem to his muscles again, and we have to treat him again from zero. Second thing, when you say functional training, it's not only that knee, it's the opposite side as well. So if I know his quads are good, strong enough to shoot the ball, but is he able to land properly on the left leg if he has to shoot with the right leg? So we need to strengthen the left hip as well. So we do the power training of left hip and endurance and strength training of right knee. So that's how we prepare them for a functional activity. Otherwise, what happens once they go back there, they come back with the injury or the test comes negative. They say, okay, fine, he's not fit enough to play. Other reason why we are facing these issues is because the trainers who are there with the teams are not basically from medical background. So best thing is, when you send a player after the rehab, when we do this, why we have kept it in such a way where we can show the live to the coaches, we can show it live to the trainers, what exactly we are doing. If they are not able to connect us live, so we keep a recording for them. This is the strength of a muscle. This is the endurance of a muscle. This is his functional activity, how much he can put load on that. So trainer knows now what he has to do after this. Because there's a big gap between the trainer and the physio and a coach, that's where the people, sports people, we are not able to bring them back after the injury. I'll give you a simple example. When Steve Waugh and I think Gillespie hit each other, and Steve Waugh fractured his nose, and Gillespie fractured his shin. Shin fracture for a fast bowler. And it took him, I think, 8 to 9 months to come back. He was bowling with a speed of 140 to 140 kilometers per hour before he got injured. And after rehab, he started bowling with a speed of 150 kilometers per hour. That's called rehab. That's where we say, okay, fine. Once you're injured, you come back and get fit and play again. You have to be much fitter than that, what you were before injury. That's what we call fitness. So that's how we do the evaluation of a muscle and tell them, okay, fine, now you are fitter than what you were. And there's nothing called rest for a player. It's a rest to the part. If any of the player's part is injured, you give a rest to that part. Don't give a whole body rest because it gets rusted and we have to start from zero again to get their body fit. So the part has to be rested. The other parts has to be continuously keep on doing. Working out in a gym or working out in a pool or working out at home. Something has to be given to them so that they are fit enough to come back to the sports. I think we have said enough regarding quads and hams evaluation. And we'll try to see that we will speak to our president, Dr. Jha, as well as Dr. Annamalai. If you're interested, we can show them other stuff as well, like shoulder evaluation, your hip evaluation, ankle evaluation. If we get an opportunity, surely we'll go ahead with that. And plus, we have the neuro pediatrics. Then we have a robotic and we have gait trainer as well as aqua training programs. So we would like to share those programs with all the physios so that whenever we get an opportunity or they get an opportunity to come and work with us or they get an opportunity to come equipments, they can without any hesitation, they can go ahead and at least have an idea of what exactly they are supposed to do. I'm really thankful to IAP, the president of IAP, secretary and treasurer, who has given us an opportunity. And I'm thankful to Adam Willey Physio Rehab Center, who has allowed us to do this webinar. Mainly Mr. Suresh Diora, who's our vice chairman, and secretary Mr. Vijay Singhal, who has allowed us to do this program and allowed us to share all these information to all the physios, whoever is watching this. And thank you, sir. Thanks, IAP, to give us this opportunity. Thanks, Dr. Ria and Dr. Aryan, Sopnil, Melvin, team of physios who have helped me to organize this. And any questions, we are here. Dr. Otra?
Yes. There are a few questions in the chat. First question is, okay, is there any disadvantage to this equipment?
Yeah, answer. Dr. Ria can answer. Is there any disadvantage to this equipment?
Only if you do not rule out the contraindications, then this equipment might have some, not the benefit, but it may have some harm on the part, and there is a chance of injury. For example, if the patient is having a cramping sensation, and if they continue to do so, they
hand, they might injure the muscle. And so in those cases, the physio needs to be careful before putting any athlete or patient on the machine.
Priya, your voice is breaking.
Not really. If you ask me, I didn't find any kind of issues with this machine. Can actually, a physio has to have a knowledge regarding the evaluation probably, and you need to know once the injury is healed and you have you are having full re- yeah, now it's clear. Hello.
Yes. So there's another question.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Hello.
Okay. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
So the next question is, any precautions we need to take while using this machine? Are you able to hear me?
The only precaution is, I think, Dr. Aryan, only precaution is, as we already said, you need to get properly. Yeah, I can hear you. Are you guys able to hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear? Okay.
Mentioned in the webinar as well, you need to be aware of the need to guide the patient that if you have any sensation of pain or any sensation of cramping or any other sensation which is not normal. A typical muscle soreness is okay, but it should not be the pain that you feel. These are some of the tips that you need to keep in mind before putting the patient on this machine. Apart from that, if during the evaluation, you need to be sure to stop the equipment immediately, and you need to do the required treatment as is needed based on what the problem is. That I can't see. And yes, one more thing, you need to make sure that how we stabilized using the straps, each the part that is not to be evaluated or treated should be very well stabilized to avoid any trip movements.
See, as I already discussed about acute injuries, once the ACL rehab, we start with the ACL rehab. If we want to go for a range of motion, say, okay, we want to take a range of motion exercises on this for the sports people. And once we start that, we have to start with a pain-free range. We cannot just push it too hard and cause unnecessary strain to the ligament as well. So at that time, we need to be careful. But once you get full range of motion, you know, a person is walking, squatting, doing lunges and other activities, and now you want to evaluate him for the strength and endurance, he's ready for that and the only flexible enough to do the testing. Yeah, Dr. Uttar.
Yes. So next question is, if we are evaluating a player for a functional activity like kicking a ball, so how would you do that evaluation with the isokinetic machine and how would you interpret it?
As I said, I discussed, I think, regarding the shooting of a soccer player who is like a striker and has to shoot the ball. So we do it more in standing. Once we reach to the functional activities, functional training program, so we put a maximum resistance around his ankle where the maximum strain comes on a quadricep. And that range has to be like if it's a kicking of a ball, which is 20 to 45 degree, you don't need to full flex or you don't need to push it too hard. But at the same time, yes, between that 20 to 45 degree, you need to kick it as hard as possible. But yes, you need to check the left hip as well. If it's a right knee, you are checking, you need to check the left hip, whether he's able to balance properly to hold that body weight on his left hip to shoot with the right quadricep muscle or shoot with the right foot.
One person has asked if you could give some insights about circuit training.
Yeah. Circuit training is basically we can use each machine for 30 seconds. Like if you have a set of 8 to 10 machines like we have here in exercise department where we do the training, where we do the training part. So what we do is like we use each machine for 30 seconds, upper and lower body as well, and train them accordingly. And say if it's 10 machines, so it becomes 1 minute or 30 seconds for each machine. Within 5 minutes, you finish one circuit and then put them on cardio, which is an interval training where you make them run for 2 minutes, jog for 1 minute, and sprint for 2 minutes. So it becomes 10 minutes program of a circuit, and give them a rest for maybe 2 to 3 minutes, have a sip of water, and take them again for one more circuit. That's when you have equipments in the gym. But if you don't have equipment, you can do the flow circuit training as well. Like you do push-ups, you do squats, you do lunges, 30 seconds. So you do one-hand push-ups, you do planks, you do frog jumps, or you do spot jumps. And then you can add on these exercise, floor exercise. You do Swiss ball, abs, you do a lot of say shoulder presses with light weight, or if you don't have dumbbells, you can use a TheraBand and do a lot of shoulder exercise with that for 30 seconds non-stop. Circuit is always non-stop for 5 to 10 minutes. Once you are done with that, take a break for 2 to 3 minutes, have a sip of water. Even if you want to take it for 5 minutes, you can go for 5 minutes break and then get back to circuit. Normally, if it's a sports person, we give 2 to 3 circuits at the time. So we don't tell them after one circuit, it's done. So once you do one circuit, give them a break, see their strength and endurance. If they're able to go for a second circuit, you can go for a second circuit. But again, if you have machine, use machines. If not, use the body weight to do that. Where you can do push-ups, you can do squats, you can do lunges. But again, I'm saying when you do squats and lunges, you need to be very sure about the quadriceps strength. As I told you, the weight, body weight gets multiplied by 9 times, you might cause a damage to a knee if you are doing the squats and lunges without strength in the quadricep and the hip muscle.
Can the isokinetic machine be used for evaluating back muscles? So could you give us some idea of how it can be used?
So ma'am, yes, we can use this isokinetic machine for the evaluation of back muscle. We have a tool number 191.
Yeah, I will just show you the tool which we use for the evaluation of a back muscle.
This is the tool number 191, where we can fix the cable to the patient waist and do that movement. So we can evaluate his isometric or isotonic endurance of his muscle.
Maybe whenever we get a chance to do the one more program on evaluation of back, we'll show you how to do it. But yes, definitely we can do it standing as well as lying down. There's a belt around the waist which we hook it with the machine, and then you have to do the movement, because this is all about movement, isokinetic movements which we do it on the machine, and then we come to know the strength and the endurance.
That was the last question.
All right.
Anything else you would like to share with us related to this?
As I already said, we can do the functional evaluation, which is must send a player before sending the player for back to sports. I would prefer if any of the player you find and you want our facilities, they're available for anyone. And the best thing what Red Cross has done is they've kept Tuesdays and Fridays for the people who are below poverty line. So we don't want anyone to say tomorrow, I couldn't use these facilities because I didn't have enough money to do these evaluations. So we have people coming from all over India, some of them from all over the world as well, who come to do the evaluation here, and we give them the program and they do it. And let me tell you, we charge only 250 rupees for those people who are below poverty line, and that's because of our Red Cross, Indian Red Cross Society Mumbai, because of our Vice Chairman Mr. Suresh Deora and Mr. Singhal, who has taken this decision with the managing committee that we will provide these facilities to everyone because it comes under Red Cross. So no one should say tomorrow we didn't have this facility to become better in this world, whether it's a sports person, whether it's a any industrial person who wants to do the activity, he can do better in life.
Thank you so much for this wonderful session. We got to understand a lot about the isokinetic machine and how we can use it. I also thank the Adam Willey Physio Rehab team for being here and explaining about the equipment. I would also like to thank the IAP technical team who've been supporting for the session along with me. And also I would thank Dr. Sanjeev Jha, IAP president, and Dr. Ruchi Vashne, IAP treasurer, for supporting to have this Zoom platform and YouTube platform for conducting the webinars. And thanks to all participants for being here today. I hope you got a good idea about the isokinetic machine. Okay, and thank you, everyone.
Thanks, ma'am. And please share the Adam Willey Physio Rehab email to all the physios. If they want to ask any question anytime, we'll try our best to answer their questions. And anytime they can call us and let us know if we can be of any assistance or any help to anyone all over India, right? Thank you.
Thank you.